And all right, good morning. This is Mini Geology. Here it is, 7 o'clock Central Time in Houston, beautiful Montrose Boulevard. Here we are with some students from Rice University in the house. And first, let's have some meditation.
So hard to leave her, she will turn to me and start to cry. And she promises the earth to me, and I believe her. After all this time, I don't know why. Oh, girl. Girl, girl. She's the kind of girl to put you down. Friends are there, you feel the fool. When they say she's looking good, she acts as if it's understood she's cool.
Good morning, Geology.
Geology?
Geology! Here we have. And who were those ones? You know, that is a girl from Rubber Soul, the Beatles, that at some point they were trying to hide from the censorship, and at some point in the background you listen. This is one of the 7 words we cannot use in the radio, right? So there was censorship there, and this was the way to escape the censorship in 1965. Well, now listen to this thing of 1789. The Congress should make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise, thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. That was the First Amendment. So here we are now, talking about free speech. We are gonna have in the house 3 students from Rice University, and they are gonna have the mics that are hot for them. So guys, don't be shy. These mics are yours, and you are here at KPFT HD3 channel. You guys, you are listening, you can call us at 713-526-8737. You can call and shout out yourself. The radio waves, they are yours, even though they are not really radio waves because we have in the high definition channel. But call us at 713-526-8737. KPFT Houston. We have in the house Laura and Eric and Michael. How's it going, guys?
Hey, it's going good.
Hey, what's up?
Good, really good to be here. Thanks for having us on.
All right, so how is that thing about talking in the radio? Ever done it before?
Not quite like this.
This is definitely my first time on the air.
Also a newbie.
All right, so guys, here is the hot mic for you. And I know I met you like very few days ago, and I invite you, you accepted, I like it a lot that you came in here. You may bring on even more friends. Did you think about anything that you want to say off the bat in here at the radio? Is there anything specific that you want to say? You want to shout out to everybody that is listening to us in the state and abroad? By the way, you know that we are listening also in the International Space Station. We have a nice brotherhood with NASA. So astronauts, your 2 or 3 are up there. Hello from Houston.
Well, if there's any astronauts out there that can actually hear me, I want to say thank you for exploring the frontiers of humanity.
That is one of the things that we have very special here in Houston. Very special thing that we have, the space industry that is bringing people out there, but also constructing and inventing new tools for technology.
Yeah, it's kind of remarkable. I heard somewhere that, you know, people at the Johnson Space Center have to be on duty at all times, even during Harvey. And so they were sleeping in cots at the Johnson Space Center to make sure that the people at the space station had all the support they needed, which is really, I don't know, it's cool that we're all working together to make sure that people are up in space doing cool science.
I do think that's a really cool aspect about being in Houston, is being close to the Johnson Space Center and seeing that side of geology as well as space geology. It's a side that I hadn't known about too much before moving to Houston. And the 5 years that I've been here doing my PhD, I've actually done a bunch of my analyses down at using some of the equipment down at NASA and interacting with the people working on the meteorites and the moon rocks. And I think that's a really fascinating part about Houston.
So, Laura, tell us something about the nice thing about being in at Rice University and studying geology. I'd like to ask you that the two aspects. I would call it the beauty and the beast. So, what are the good things that you have there, and above all, what are the things that they don't work, the things that you don't like, those things that cannot be said, that there are taboos. So here we are to open a debate about that. So Laura, you have the floor.
Awesome. Okay. Well, my Beauty and the Beast is somewhat intertwined, so I might be able to answer both at once a little bit. And it's I guess similar to what I just said, is that being at Rice gives us a lot of exposure to all of the benefits and maybe negatives about Houston, geology in Houston in particular. One of them, as I mentioned, is being really close to Johnson Space Center, which is neat. But I think a great thing about Houston is the oil and gas industry being here. It really opens up one route for careers, and it also opens up the Houston public to being aware of geology. I've noticed that around the community, people are just very familiar with the science and very eager to talk about it, and I think that's really important.
So do you think so? Is when you chat with people that aren't related to geoscientists, they are aware about the importance of geology?
A lot of them, yes. Most of the people in Houston, either they know somebody in oil and gas, or they're in oil and gas, or at least they respect the importance it has in the economy.
So what is the perception that people have about geology here in Houston, according to your knowledge? Is this related to jobs and economy, or something else?
I think mostly, yes. I think there's just a lot of awareness, a lot of students who are aware of STEM type careers because there are so many geologists around them. Whereas I think if you go to other parts of the country, I'm from the Northeast, it's a very, very unheard of field. Not many people even know it exists. And up there, the only career path they really talk about is either going into academia or a few will go into environmental consulting. I didn't even know about oil and gas until I came down here, and it seems like it's just common knowledge and all the kids are aware of it. And, you know, petroleum it's at the Natural History Museum. Kids learn about it at a very young age in exploration geology.
So you said you're from the Northeast?
Yes.
How do people from the Northeast, they look at the geologists in the South?
That's a great question. I'm not actually sure. Didn't talk too much about it. There's certainly a community up there that's heavily environmental and don't really understand what the importance of oil and gas, and will just condemn it for being bad for the environment. And
where does it start, this bias? It's because you're from there, you grew mm-hmm. up there, right? So mm-hmm. what is that make you think that geologists working in energy or in oil and gas, mm-hmm. they have kind of living in the dark side of the moon?
I think it comes from ignorance, to be honest. It's just that up there you don't really understand what that industry does for this country and how important it is. I think if people up there want, you know, if some of my friends up there would say, you know, let's get rid of it, and get rid of it, and their lives change completely, and I don't think they realize exactly how dependent they are on this industry. You know, plastics and things. Most people don't even know that that's related.
So it seems that you should do something, guys, to explain to your peers what is the importance, being open to the debate, but try to explain the importance of it.
For sure. And that's one thing, that's sort of what I was getting at about being in Houston, is that people are so aware of it that it makes outreach really easy. And I think that's a really important part about geology, because geology is around everybody. Like in Houston, it's really good to be aware of your surroundings when things like Harvey happen. It's good to know where your floodplains are and where your high ground is. Geology is a really important aspect for just public life. And I think Houston makes that easy to do. And I think it needs to happen more elsewhere so that people are aware about the impacts on their own lives.
Eric, do you want to tell us something about your beauty of being at the Department of Geology?
Well, actually, I had some sort of things to weigh in about this conversation about whether about how to correctly frame the importance of geoscience careers and industry in our lives. For example, so, you know, I had a professor when I was an undergraduate student that was really fond of going through all of the different things in our lives that require molybdenum. And it turns out molybdenum...
Wait a second, what is molybdenum? Explain to everybody what
molybdenum. Oh, right. Okay, so molybdenum is an element in the periodic table that is... It exists in the transition metals section. So it's related to iron
and, that's enough.
And titanium and a number of other things like that. So but the important thing to know is that it's very rare. It's very hard to find, and it is essential for a number of different things that we use in our everyday lives. So for example, all cars contain about a kilogram, 2.5 pounds or so.
Oh my God.
Of molybdenum. Because it makes the steel stronger. And so that molybdenum has to come from somewhere. And so we need a geologist to go find it. So, you know, mining is also, you know, we like to disparage the oil and gas industry because it tends to, like the Exxon Valdez or something, it tends to create really catastrophic scenes in very picturesque locations. But mining is another very important industry that is often forgotten because it's so... because it enables so many things in the background, but it's also critical for us to understand and to interact with. So it's essential, but you know, the people, you know, who decry the mining industry and who decry the oil and gas industry, I think one of the things that's most important is to learn that to interact with those industries and to work with them rather than to choose to oppose them unilaterally without any sort of
equivocation. So do you have any specific idea to try to break this loophole where it seems that people that they are being educated far away from industries related to energy resources, they are biased against the people working in them? Maybe I think the perception is because they are responsible for the pollution.
Sure. Yeah, I think that's definitely one of the aspects. And I think my answer would be that you should try it out. Like, people should work in the oil and gas industry. And then, you know, also on the other side, I think oil and gas industry folks should have a chance to go and work with environmental groups. So, you know, that's another side of it that, you know, I know a lot of people who do internships in oil and gas. I did one. It's great. You know, it's a very powerful learning experience.
Well, I have to say, and I always shout it out in hearing the radio, that I'm one of those. Right? I'm coming out. I'm a geologist working in the energy industry, and I'm proud to be there in doing the things that I do and trying to share the things that I do with others in the community. Having you in here, having the mini geology here in the radio, and trying to build bridges. So having people like you, and we need actually another part here to discuss about this topic. So I invite you to call at 713-526-8737 if you have a different idea, different point of view on the geologists that are working in industry, specifically in the energy sector. So 713-526-8737. Any other idea about this, Mike? Mike, talk at the mic.
Hey. Well, I don't know too much about the oil and gas industry, so I don't really have too much to weigh in on that topic.
Perfect. So tell us about the beauty of
okay.
being a geologist.
Well, first of all, I would like to talk about the beauty of being at Rice. I'm a first-year student at Rice, so I'm pretty new, so I don't have too much to weigh in. But I will say this. Rice offers a type of intellectual freedom that other colleges that I looked into don't necessarily offer. And what I mean by that is, for example, I have a lot of other friends that went to pursue master's and PhD degrees in geology at other universities, and a lot of time they would be handed a project or kind of, you know, follow in the footsteps of their advisor and, you know, kind of have their hands held the whole time and not necessarily be part of the process of actually coming up with your own problem and coming up with your own ways to solve that. So at Rice, I know, at least in my experience, I'm sure Laura went through a similar thing because she's in the same group as me. Your first year is really dedicated towards searching the scientific literature, assessing problems, and creating a solution to kind of attack that problem experimentally, theoretically, or if you like have a field site that you find really interesting.
So why do you think you have this special freedom at your university? Why do you think that other universities they don't have it? It has something to do with the fact that Rice is a private university?
I think that might have something to do with it. I think it's also that they value the importance of learning that skill of being kind of independent intellectually and having to have the personal responsibility to go out and actually devise a project. Especially, I know like a lot of people at Rice end up going into academia or some type of research job, and in those jobs you absolutely need that skill to be able to think creatively, to be able to come up with creative solutions. And it's kind of hard to gain that skill if you come into college or a PhD or a master's degree with kind of a project, you know, stamped to your forehead.
How did you find out that you have this kind of freedom at Rice University before going to Rice University? How did you know that?
Coming on the campus visit and just talking to professors and realizing...
So is in the air is something that you perceive, something that you feel that you don't really need to read any specific news about it. It's something that you understand that you have that environment that allows you to be more creative and free.
Maybe, so this is Eric again, maybe it's worthwhile going through. So a lot of people who are listening may not know intimately the process of applying to a PhD. And how you get there, so
wait a second. So you're all studying for a PhD?
We are all PhD students. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So your numbers, first year, fifth year, third year, is related to the PhD.
Yes. Correct. Exactly.
Oh
right.
My gosh! Such an intensity of culture in here. So wait a second, Eric. You are at which year?
I am just starting my second year.
Second year. Mike is first year. Yep. Laura.
I'm halfway through my fifth year.
Okay, good.
She's almost done. She's about to cross the finish line.
Fingers crossed.
The marathons.
Right. So as you're applying for a PhD, one of the things you do is you, especially in the geosciences, one of the big things that we do is we contact advisors or we contact academics, professors far in advance, and we begin dialogues with them to sort of determine what they're, you know, whether they're even interested in accepting new students. So most advisors only have 5 to 6 students at a time.
That is a low number?
Compared to some fields, right. So like there's some biosciences researchers, some people who don't work in the biomedical community who may have 40 or 50 graduate students in a lab. But geosciences, it tends to be a little bit smaller, tighter knit lab group community. So I think, Laura, your lab is 5 to 6, right?
6 right now.
It's 6 right now. Okay, yeah. So you contact your advisor well in advance, you end up, and you talk with them, and usually you propose a couple ideas to show that you have thoughts that you want to, or ideas that you want to pursue. And advisors, you know, if you apply to the school, and then they'll support your application, and then if you get past all of these stages up to this point, you get invited for a visit. And so oftentimes when you're going for these visits, you talk with the professors and all the faculty members and you discuss what you would like to research, because that's the core of a PhD, is producing original research. And so what I found is that all of the schools that I went to, you know...
How many?
Only two. So I should probably maybe say not all or something like that. It was... No, two total.
Two total?
So, right. So I visited... at the University of Oregon, and then I visited here. And the thing that I noticed that was different between the two is that, like, there's, you know, this is, it depends on your perspective, but I, you know, at Rice, when I came to visit, I had conversations with my advisor, and his questions to me were always, well, what do you want to look into? What's your, like, what are your ideas? What are you interested in pursuing? And then at Oregon, I had proposed something very specific. I had proposed a sort of specific project in my initial introduction, which just so happened to correspond with a grant that the advisor had gotten recently. And so I would be working on a specific project, and then all of our discussions were about aspects of that project. So it was much less open-ended, which is, you know, depending on your perspective, some people might find that very refreshing because, you know, there's a confined area and that they're going to work in, and it provides some sort of, it provides a level of certainty and a level of focus that's good for early career academics. But for me, it was really attractive, this idea of just sort of having an open-ended, no limits, whatever you want, what are you interested in kind of discussion. And that I think is pretty typical here at Rice, actually, because I think we have this unique ability of accepting students and then sort of just trusting that they'll, you know, trusting them to come up with their own projects rather than
handing
them something.
It's nice. It seems that there's some familiar environment, so that is like a family.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Yeah.
So, tell us about, especially you, Mike, that you just arrived and you're fresh. What are the taboos? What are the things that you don't talk about in the environment where you are? What are the things that you don't say? And we want to say them in here because we want to start opening a debate about those things. Is there anything that you think that this is not really right to do on campus?
I have not gotten that, like, that vibe yet from the campus. I'm a fairly open person. I don't really reserve myself too much. So I can't really think of any taboos that I'd be afraid to say that I, like, actually think.
Laura, you maybe campus, you're more expert.
Yeah,
you
have she already. Might have better.
You have more
this.
Experience than
yeah.
I.
Well, I don't know if there's anything particularly that sinister, but.
The dark underbelly.
I guess my only beast side of this small community, and I guess the sort of the positive that Eric was talking about and that Michael was talking about are, you know, the focus on research and the fact that we're giving freedom to research whatever we want. And I think this is really important, and sort of the intention of the department is that they're building researchers. They are teaching us to become our own independent scientists. So we learn to identify our own problems, and like Michael said, we learn how to solve them. And I think this is a wonderful aspect, but one part that maybe our department is lacking, in being in Houston, we have the industry of oil and gas, and we have, like Michael mentioned, our department is very academic centric in that a lot of students graduate their PhDs and continue on in academia. But I think because of that, we're missing a little bit of the application side. Being a fifth year and looking at career options and jobs after this, I feel there's a little bit of a lack of preparing us for other types of positions. We learn a lot about staying in Houston and, as you are aware of, working in oil and gas, and we learn a lot about how to be research scientists and continuing in the footsteps of our own advisors. But there isn't a whole lot of
awareness. So in a sense, you are kind of trained to become an academic, and that is just because of the nature of the beast, which is trying to recreate yourself.
Absolutely. Yes, I do think it's very much a... You teach what you know, kind of a symptom.
So what would you propose to do in order to have a slight overlap with industry before you finish?
It's a great question, and I'm still working on the answer for that. I personally would like a lot more exposure to various things before I make my choice.
You mean like something like internships?
Internships, or even just getting speakers in to talk to us about what they do. I've done a couple of outreach volunteer positions this summer myself, showing middle, high school, and even elementary students, as well as teaching a couple classes at Rice, showing people exactly what we do, exactly what our research entails. Michael and I are in a lab group that uses some fairly rare experimental apparatus. And so just exposing people to that kind of research who possibly wouldn't have known about it otherwise opens eyes. And I think we need the same thing to learn about other careers. I think we just need a little bit of more awareness about how we can use the skills that we are gaining from our time at Rice, our experiences, and our great advisors, our small community, using that.
Well, let me tell you that in my experience coming from the other side of the pond, I have to say that we now here in North America are very lucky in the sense that the interaction that you have from industry and academia is way stronger than in Europe. Now, I say lucky, but somebody else can call at 713-526-8737 and tell me that we are the opposite. We are not lucky, because if you have intimate relationships, you may end up killing the pure curiosity that you should have in science. So it become kind of an incestus, and you don't want to have that, because you're not going to give pure fruits that came out from pure curiosity, because of that, in this situation, research is related to application. Even though maybe you don't see it right now, it could be that part of the funds that they help you survive during these 5 or 6 years, they come from industry. So there's a long-term view always related to application. And even if now, living in Houston, everything becomes relative. So if you're not really working day by day in the energy companies, maybe it seems that you are completely detached. But when you look at it in perspective and you go to the other side of the pond and you're looking for a job, you would say, oh my gosh, I would really like to be there in Houston with all those 5,000 businesses related to oil and gas where I could certainly find a job. But tell me more about your other beast, Mike. So you said you don't see any taboo, but you should have a beast. What is the worst thing that happened to you in university right now at your first year of PhD?
Falling asleep for too long on the hammocks behind the library.
I mean,
it's been pretty good so far. I don't know what else to say.
You do have a unique experience of having survived a hurricane in your first couple of weeks at Rice.
Yeah, but I live right down the street, and we didn't get hit that hard. So from my perspective, kind of just looked like a bad storm. But I'm definitely privileged in that respect. So I didn't really venture out too far to look at the chaos. So it wasn't necessarily too bad.
Yeah, for you personally.
For me personally, but of course I understand that for thousands and
you don't want to. We don't want to do the ostrich, because down there, we want to do the drone. I've seen some images from the drone. They are goosebumps. And anyhow, coming out and reaching out to the community is something very important. You would learn way more about how complicated it is. The position we have and how much responsibility we have. Eric?
Yeah, it is kind of crazy that we have a number of people at Rice in both. So Rice has a geology department, but we also have a civil engineering department that does a lot of things that are very related to geology. And there is so much research that has come out of trying to understand the impacts of Harvey. There are, we have researchers working on how sediment is accumulating in the bayous and how, contamination from, either like processing plants or like down in Beaumont or like dry cleaners, you know, that may have closed 50 years ago, how Harvey is remobilizing those contaminants, and or, you know, even how the flooding recedes and what the patterns of flooding are in the city. These are all really important questions that we're, that Rice is actively pursuing, and with, in collaboration with other researchers, of course. So yeah, so Harvey was truly devastating, and one of the amazing things about academia is that, you know, we're presented with a challenge in this scenario, not only to try and help people in sort of concrete ways by mucking out their houses and stuff like that, but also to help us understand what happened and what we can do in the future to forestall some of these bad consequences.
Going off of that, I've noticed that this call for immediate scientific observation, it has to be quick, you know, in order to avoid any other external effects on.
Tell us
on
more about this quick call. What does it really mean?
Well, I've noticed that there's been a quick response from our department in getting out and making these observations, but there's also been very quick response that I think social media has enabled for. I've noticed professors in our department have put out a call and collaborated with other scientists in Houston. Collaborated with, you know, professors at the University of Houston or other scientists in energy, for example, and they're trying to get on this quicker and help each other out. And I think that's an example of a very small example of the repercussion of this whole disaster is the big community feel. And I think Michael is a little bit on the plus side of living through a hurricane in his first couple of weeks here. He's seeing Rice at its strongest, at its most togetherness. There's a big community feel. And I think as well, countrywide, there's been a lot of interaction with scientists around the country helping us as well to analyze what happened and see if we can mediate the risks better in the future.
Yeah, I witnessed myself the heart of Houston beating. The beat of the heart was so strong and fast. And man, I thought that Houston was more kind of a neutral city. Instead, I saw that people, they came out, they help in the neighborhood. In my little community, I saw very nice things that they were exceptional in the sense that they were not done on a daily basis. I would expect them, I would like to have them done every day, but that was an exceptional situation when you really saw the humanity in the people of the city and the warmth that you have in this nice and colorful community.
Yeah, we are a passionate people in Houston.
Yeah. Oh, you're a Houstonian?
Sure. Well, not originally, but now adopted.
Okay. Okay. So. Like me. You can have whatever accent you want, but you're from Houston.
Right, exactly. Well, yeah, well, I...
Where are you from originally?
I'm from North Carolina originally.
Okay.
But I didn't acquire an accent because my mom is from Maryland, and so it was... I never had a southern drawl passed
you
to me with the butter.
You think you don't have an accent? Just go to Italy and try to talk in Italian.
Oh, I bet it would be horrendous.
So tell me, what is your beast, Eric?
Oh, actually, it is, like Laura was saying, it's intertwined with the beauties, as they always are.
That reminds me of the movies of David Lynch, you know? Is there scary and you would say freaky, but then what he shows is that the evil is, as you just said, intertwined with the good. It's the same thing.
It reminds me of Pan's Labyrinth, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, so, you know, the great joy that I have of working here and is that I have been given ample slack rope to work with, right? Like I have like I've been given a lot of slack to do whatever it is that I'm interested in, and you know that has taken many forms, but as my advisor once said, he said, I don't want to give you enough rope to hang yourself with. because that's the problem, is that, like, you know, with too much freedom there is a distinct possibility, because, you know, we're not trained scientists yet. Well, Laura is. She's a trained scientist. But Michael and I are still novices. We're not among the initiated. So it's distinctly important for us for the department to, in some ways, to confine us and provide us with a little bit of structure. And I think they do that, but it is, we definitely err here on the side of freedom, and that definitely has the possibility of allowing people to, you know, to sort of, yeah, hang themselves on their on their freedom, because it's important.
What would be the analog of hanging himself? What does it mean that you never conclude anything?
Right. So like if you're working on a problem, but you're allowed complete freedom to pursue it as you wish. We're not trained scientists, so we may not have learned the critical ability of realizing when something just isn't going to work, or when some project is way too big for 5 years. Some things require a career. There are some very simple questions in our community that the best minds have worked on for decades and won't be solved in 5 years for a PhD. So you shouldn't ask the question, for example, of where do rivers begin and how does that happen? Because that is way too much. You know, that's too much to bite off. And if somebody does that, then they run the distinct possibility of never finishing their PhD. And so that's one of the key things that I think the department is, we do allow people a lot of freedom, but there is the potential, you know, I feel sometimes that maybe my projects just aren't going to pan out.
Tell me more about the philosophy of cherry picking the topic, like with this example that you gave us about where the rivers begin. How do you define? So you have a big question that is out there debating in the scientific community, and then how you define how small with respect to that big question is the thing that you are trying to achieve?
I like to think of it as I like to think of the Earth as, let's just imagine all of Earth as a, Earth has layers, right? So Earth has a crust on the outside, which is very thin. It's almost like an eggshell. And then Earth has, a mantle in the middle, which is a little thicker. It's like the egg white. And then Earth has a core, which is sort of like the egg yolk. Up until high school, you learn if that's all of human knowledge is represented by Earth and those layers. The Earth, what you learn in high school might be the core, it might be the egg yolk. What you learn in undergraduate, as an undergraduate student, might comprise the mantle and maybe some extra part of it. And then when you get to your PhD, you're pushing on one pinprick of the surface of the Earth, and you're trying to push up a mountain to increase the size. You're basically trying to create new knowledge. And the way to find the idea is that we have these broad questions that sort of the community is trying to pursue, and what you need to do is find something where you think you can make a concrete advancement in the amount of knowledge about the world, that you can make a new discovery, that you can make a new conclusion. And the way to do that is to break the problem apart into pieces. And since, you know, if you have 500 pieces, 400 of them are going to be completely unknown. And so you have to find one of them that you think you can figure out and increase that number to 401. That's the way to do it. And that's an art, not a science. It requires sort of a lot of intuition, which is why a lot of people pursue more than one project. So they might pick three, so that in case one of them doesn't pan out, you still have two that are viable.
Isn't that thing that you just explained now, this concept, something that should be taught to the student, or is something that you can never teach because it's so difficult that you have just to grab it? It's like going out in the field and looking at the outcrops. It's very difficult to explain how to tackle an outcrop. What do you start describing? So there's some things that you just acquire, you know, like a little duck following the mother, would you pretend that somebody explained you these things before you start such an important project, which is going to take 5, 6, 7 years of your life?
Well, I guess I can weigh in as a fifth year. reassure Eric, at least, that they won't let you hang yourself. part of our training is definitely to learn where our limits are, to learn where our bounds are. That's sort of the stepping stone of a PhD is... We come in as students, and I think we leave as independent scientists. And that transition, our advisors there to handhold a little at the beginning and to just kind of direct us, give us gentle nudges. And one of those nudges is always, you're overreaching or even you're underreaching. You know, maybe this is too small of a project to come up with.
What does it happen more often? You underreach or you overreach?
Usually it's overreaching. Particularly, I think most people who are pursuing a PhD have some kind of a curious mind, and sometimes that curiosity pulls a little bit too far. But the advisors have many years of experience themselves of, you know, figuring out exactly how much they can put into one project, into one grant, and they can direct us when needed.
So you have some kind of like official coaching telling you these things, or is an unofficial good familiar relationship with your mentors?
Very unofficial, yes. Okay. It's more of a check and balances. They'll keep an eye on you. We do also have, at the end of our second year of PhD, we are all required to do what is called a qualifying exam. And for that exam, we present two projects we would like to do during our PhD. And we have our PhD committees. They watch our presentations and they question us about it, and they question our knowledge and our preparedness to do these projects. And I think that's the single most important part of the PhD, and the single most stressful part of the PhD as well. It's a very big stepping stone, but I think it's there for that check. You present projects and they check that you understand the scope and the feasibility of doing those projects. And the committee will for sure let you know if they think it's not a good idea.
Yeah, I'm kind of going through this process currently, so it's kind of nice to hear graduate students with a little bit more experience talk about it. So I know I talked about earlier how you're offered this wide range of intellectual freedom, but like Eric said, that necessarily isn't always... You got to find the balance between a freedom and a constraint, because there's some things that you just aren't going to be able to do, especially if it's like for either your first paper that you're going to write. You don't want to tackle something that has, you know, a 10% probability of even being able to get data on that, because it kind of lowers your morale right off the bat. And you're like, oh, maybe this isn't for me. So I'm kind of going through this process right now and kind of just chatting with my advisor. We're just talking about papers that, you know, I find interesting, that he finds interesting. And I mean, he will tell me if I have an idea that, you know, probably isn't going to work. So there definitely is that fine balance between actually letting somebody pick a problem, but also they kind of hold your hand a little bit and be like, well, maybe you should, you know, not try to, you know, tackle the biggest problems right off the bat, because there's you know, a likelihood that it might not work out too good for you.
I see. I know that thing about the too much freedom. I know I experienced when I arrived here, going to the supermarket and I was looking for milk. Oh my gosh, I spent half an hour looking at the different kind of milks that you may purchase, the brands, the colors, the kind of vitamins you have in. The percentage of fat. That's something that I need to teach to my kids, how to choose when you have too much freedom.
So there's, somebody did a really funny study at a supermarket related to this, where they took a display and they put on the display sort of five different kinds of jam, like strawberry, raspberry, blackberry, and they had five different kinds, and they observed people getting the jam, buying it, and then taking it home, and then they would actually interview them afterwards. So yeah, they did this whole study on this, and then they replaced the stand with a stand with 30 different kinds of jam, you know, boysenberry, honeysuckle, all of these sorts of things. And so eventually after they compared their results from the 30 jams and the 5 jams, and they found that people who purchased jam from the stand with more variety, with too much freedom, were not only less likely to buy jam, but they were more likely to be dissatisfied with their jam when they had it, which is such an amazing idea, you know, being dissatisfied with jam. you know, because it's like, you know, that you had more options,
yeah,
or something like
it's
that.
Psychologic.
And so it's this really remarkable thing where if you do just sort of limit the scope of what you're looking for, then it does, there is a real potential to get more value out of it.
I see.
Certainly. I did my master's program in the UK, and across the pond, it is very much, they hand you a project and you do the project that the advisor was thinking of. And I was looking to do my PhD either over there or come over here. And part of the enticement was I could do something different over here and choose what I wanted. But also I found that actually quite terrifying as well. And part of picking a project that already existed is I knew it would work. I knew exactly what I was doing, and I knew exactly how long it would take, which incidentally is a lot shorter in the UK than here. But I do think it's an important part of our education is being able to learn how to make these decisions ourselves and to not be overwhelmed by jam when we go into the store, I think is a useful skill to have.
So Laura, talking a little bit more in specific about the things that you do and you study, what is that you are studying and what are you trying to achieve? And is there any relationship with an application to the society or how the society is going to benefit from the things that you are studying?
Absolutely. So what I research is carbon in magma. And I do high-pressure, high-temperature experiments so that I can recreate the conditions inside the Earth when we have magma forming. And I look at what happens when that magma interacts with rocks that have carbon in, such as the rocks that we have throughout Texas, carbonates. And in the goal is to determine how much CO2 we are putting out from these volcanoes that might have more CO2 than others. And to better constrain that number will help with climate modeling. We need to know what carbon is being input into the atmosphere from nature, and one of those is volcanoes.
Where would the magma interact with those specific rocks? In the chamber, outside of the chamber, or where?
It'll be right along the edge of the magma chamber. So this magma chamber will pop up. It'll intrude into these rocks that were already sitting there in the crust. And if those rocks have carbon in, the magma will dissolve the carbon and release it as CO2. So it's a sort of a way of mobilizing carbon that has been stored in the crust for a long time and mobilizing it and sending it to the atmosphere. So
whatever you study is related to the environment today, or you're trying to do studies in the past and try to apply what you learned to do climate models in the past?
Both. The answer is both. There are certain volcanoes that we know of today that are undergoing this process. Actually, Italy has a number of these volcanoes that pass through carbonates. Indonesia has a big problem with this.
You see, I knew that we were not really polluting Italy. I mean, it's the volcanoes. Yeah. Everybody knows that. Come on. And then they say we're dirty and we throw things.
Oh, yeah.
Come on. Volcanoes.
Yeah, four volcanoes are now a scapegoat.
Don't tell politicians.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, today this is actually a fairly small phenomenon, only in a few locations around Earth. But it is important in those locations because if we increase CO2 in these volcanoes, this is the part of my research that I think is the most application focused, is if you increase the CO2 in those volcanoes, you can make them more explosive. You can make the hazards more dangerous. And for example, this increased the intensity of the eruptions in Indonesia and caused a lot more destruction.
Yeah, that we like it. You know, in Italy we give name to the Plinian explosion.
Yep.
Super Plinian explosion, volcano
gives
the other
uh-huh.
name, the explosion. Yeah, we have a lot of
yeah,
the like
Italians contributed a lot.
and you, Mike, what about you? What is your subject of your study, and how would you apply that in the society?
Yeah, well, like I said earlier, I don't have a set project yet, but I'm working in the same group as Laura, so I would like to also run high pressure, high temperature experiments to better understand the interior of our Earth. And if the interior of our Earth makes up, you know, a overwhelming majority of the volume, and it controls what we see at the surface. The surface is just a skin kind of riding on this river of this, you know, this elastic layer underneath. And if we're going to understand what we're observing on the surface, we have to understand the basic mechanism that is driving these processes that we observe at the surface. On another aside, in terms of science having direct applications to humanity, while I understand that it is important to, you know, put those applications in your proposals, if you look at, you know, science historically, it often never starts with how is this gonna help humanity. A lot of it stems from, you know, original intellectual curiosity, which then ends up having a lot of applications for humanity.
But that is way enough. I mean, if your goal is like to get people to be more curious, oh my gosh, that's a great accomplishment.
Yeah, no, exactly. So I guess for an example, at the, you know, the turn of the century, when we were really starting to kind of understand what matter was, what the electron is, what, you know, the structure of the atom, the structure of matter in general. You know, at the time it was in society, it was kind of conceived like, why are we putting so much money towards this research that seems, you know, not very applicable to humanity, whatever. Like, people are talking about these, you know, these theoretical particles that are buzzing around. It's a bunch of, you know, crazy physicists in some back room having, you know, intellectual playdates about, you know, the about reality. But it turns out that, you know, understanding the structure of matter led to the creation of the transistor, which led to pretty much every technology that we take for granted today, and which pretty much controls the backbone of the global economy. So it's really hard to foresee exactly where scientific research will lead you, but I think it's much more important to stem a curiosity within society and get people just wanting to pursue science for, you know, intellectual curiosity reasons. And then oftentimes, as history shows us, the research done often helps in the future. So yeah, that's my take
on it.
Where
do you see yourself in the future, in the academia, in industry? Or like having your own enterprise?
Well, I guess I have 5 years or so to figure that out. As for now, I just love to learn. I continue my education because I love geology. I found geology and I kind of fell in love with it. And it's such a crazy ride. Like, every day I learn something that just blows my mind. And it, you know, it makes every day worth living. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. Who knows where I'll be in 5 years or so.
So you didn't join the... Your team, and you didn't start the PhD with already a preconceived idea in mind of where you want to go. It's not that you started a PhD saying, I want to become a professor.
Absolutely not. I'm doing it because I love to learn about this stuff, and this affords me an opportunity to do so and maybe do something good with it at the end of 5 years.
Sounds like a professor to me.
Well. I bet on that as well.
Yeah. I don't know anyone in another profession who says, oh, my primary motivation is just to learn things. That's
it's
such
fun,
a,
though.
That
that's,
is such a professor
it's
thing
such
to say.
A fun,
that
it's such a fun aspect of life,
see,
though.
Only academics are motivated only by knowledge acquisition. That's great. No, it's awesome. I'm just saying.
But that makes me feel better than anything else, is like is learning things and, you know, realizing our place in not only this world but, you know, the universe in general, you know?
And that's why we're still students at age, you know, 30.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. And that's like, and that's why being on college campuses and doing academic work is so attractive, because it means that you do get to just, like, literally your job is just to answer questions.
Yeah, in fact, I mean, I see that as is an environment where you are still virgin and you have to remain so to become a student. Otherwise, you're going to be affected too much by other forces, that it could be too strong for you. It could crunch you, like if you allow industry to penetrate too deeply into the academic world. You won't have that kind of freedom to study this kind of curiosities, because the kind of time span and the pace that industry has is different than the pace that academics they have. So industry understands very well that science is going to create some new technology, the things that you study today is going to create new technology in decades, and is very well accepted. But the pace of the market, which drives the pace and the movement of the industry and the strategies, is way shorter. So they need that kind of application. So application is the same word, but the application has different time spans. So industry is looking for application that you can apply in 4, 5, 10 years, and academia maybe is looking for application that you can apply in decades or one century from now. So that is very important to keep a balance on these things. It is also true that if you don't have these interactions from industry and academia, then academia may drift away and go up in the ivory tower, and maybe that tower may become a bubble tower, and then you don't understand anymore each other.
Yeah, there's something to be said for acquiring knowledge for knowledge's sake and acquiring knowledge for progress. I think it's good to balance the two.
Yeah. And what about you, Eric? What are you doing and where are you going?
Oh, I'm a lot like Michael. I'm still unpolluted by the
Oh,
the
you don't like the term virgin. Yeah, I know. Your friends are listening.
But so I'm still very much on the track for academia. It's, you know, for me, it is the joy of just having my job be to answer questions that really gets me up in the morning. And it's great. So the questions I'm trying to answer are things related to, I study the Earth's, so Michael studies the Earth's interior and how it's driving the engines of the surface. Laura studies the pipes that transmit stuff from the center to the surface. And I just study the surface. Because for me, it's, the funnest thing in the world is to watch things happen while they are happening. And so that happens, that joy is satisfied nowhere better than in rivers, and on coastlines. So what I study are lowland rivers, and in particular, how rivers interact with oceans to create landforms. So so you may think that the most dramatic landforms are mountains and volcanoes and things like that, but in some ways, the most dramatic and dynamic and changing landforms are landforms that are made by rivers. And the topography is very subtle. You know, river, if you go down to Galveston, it's not like it's hilly. You know, it's not interesting to look at from your car. But when you get around and walk around on it and you look at maps of it, it's truly amazing that the rivers and the streams and the coastline is building shapes that then change how the river behaves. So there's always a feedback between the landscape and the driving force. And so I study those driving forces and feedbacks. And what I'm interested in is understanding how those driving forces and feedbacks in rivers, how they respond to things like climate or
what is
uplift.
What is the driving force that is affecting the river?
Oh, the river is, it's so many things. The thing is, they're very complicated systems. They take, you know, it's water provided from upstream, from the mountains. It's waves from the ocean. It's storm surges. It's hurricanes. All of these things interact with the river to change the way that we, to change what's happening in it. And so one of the things that I'm looking at right now is looking into the ancient past and looking at rocks that are preserved in Colorado. And what I'm trying to understand is how changes in ancient climate that we can know from geochemistry or chemical signatures, how those changes in climate impacted the river and the landscape. So we can tell that the landscape changed significantly, and what we're interested in is what are the feedbacks that allowed that to happen. So you know, That's kind of where I'm.
That is the easiest thing to understand, to relate to society, as many of the societies they develop around water and are around rivers, right?
Right. So the rocks that I'm looking at are probably in a location similar to something that we might be living in Houston, and so that landscape change is very real for us potentially as climate change moves forward.
All right, so it is 7:59 in beautiful Montrose, Houston. This is HD3 KPFT Houston. We're here with three students from University of Rice. I invite you to write me at minigeology@gmail.com. Mini as M-I-N-I, geology, minigeology@gmail.com. And you are going to be very welcome to come in here and sit in here, and we can chat and talk about your problems, your ideas, your frustrations, the taboos. And you can check the Twitter account at minigeology, as well as the Facebook page at same minigeology. And write down the number to call next time, 713-526-8737. That's all for now, folks. Have a nice day. Bye from Mini Geology and all of these beautiful guys. Bye.